This video is brought to you by Skillshare.
Ready and action.
David Fincher is one of the top Hollywood directors known for using technology in invisible ways to enhance storytelling and performances. I had the chance to connect with Ben Insler, the first assistant editor on Fincher's recent multi-Academy Award-nominated film, Mank. I wanted to find out how he, as the AE, helps his editor Kirk Baxter and Fincher in making the best film possible, and what it takes to become an assistant editor who gets to work on A-list feature film productions. Ben, thank you so much for having me over in your home. I feel really comfortable being there. With This Guy Edits, we always love to like talk about the process. What I'm really interested in is to see the creative side of how a scene comes together, but from the point of view of the assistant editor.
Each day, a part of a scene is shot, and we actually process the dailies very quickly. Shoot day one arrives to editorial the morning of shoot day two. We quickly organize the dailies by a single take for Kirk to start reviewing. You know, there might be three cameras shooting on that one take. And he'll look at that and he'll say, where do I start making the decisions? It's almost as if in that moment, how would I cut this scene with just the angles that are provided in this take? And then we'll take that and we'll mirror that across all of the takes so that he can essentially watch 15 takes of that scene and always see the creative editorial intent that he's already deduced from watching that first take.
We can illustrate this novel concept by going through one of the actual edited timelines from the film Mank. This is Kirk's edit from take one of the scene. Notice he's chosen to start with a medium shot on Gary Oldman.
You, Mr. Mayor? Real families root for...
Then he cuts to a wide reverse shot showing his POV. And then this is repeated in take two.
Are you, Mr. Mayor? Real families root for each other.
You can
other.
See that it mirrors the edit choices made by Kirk in take one. And then this is take three.
Are you, Mr. Mayor? Root for each other in good times.
Also mirroring the edit choices of take one. The subsequent takes are organized by the assistant editor into a timeline adjacent to each other, so Kirk can easily and quickly compare performances from each take.
The ability to compare takes adjacently is very powerful.
Would you say these scenes come together quite fast?
Kirk really cranks through these things. He puts them together very quickly. They're workable scenes very quickly.
Is in grave financial difficulty. I am asking everyone in the MGM family to take a painful step. I am asking to roll back salaries. I don't want to.
Many A-list directors are known for doing a vast amount of takes for each camera setup to allow the actors to fully explore their performance and character.
Generally, what would you say, how many takes are there for a setup?
I know that that's a popular Fincher question.
Yes.
There are some setups that I know everybody has heard about where there are 60, 70 takes.
Really?
And there are some setups where there are three.
So most of the time, though, it's like 10 or less.
No, I would say most of the time it's probably somewhere between 15 and 30. There's a scene in Mank where Rita walks in and she finds Mank having drunk himself to sleep.
Mank. Mr. Mank was...
There were a lot of takes of that bottle falling on the floor, but that's a very simple thing to do a lot of takes of. So yeah. It's not surprising that they shot a lot of options and tried to find possibly multiple perfect options for that.
David Fincher is known for using different camera takes and compositing them into one split screen so that he can show the strongest performances by all the actors, even if they didn't actually happen at the same time.
Why don't we just talk about the way that we do split screens? We actually do that a bunch to sometimes line up performances or clean up things that either shouldn't be there or may be distracting. And actually a good example of that is right here. This is a split screen. Mm-hmm. What you're looking at right now is the final. So I'll play that first.
Well, I vote yes.
And this is actually a split screen of three separate takes, all full takes, and we've split up the frame into three pieces to get that performance to be exactly what we want.
Okay.
We have one piece that's Louis V. Mayer. We have one piece that is the right side of the crowd, and we have one piece that's the left side of the crowd. This is all the same take, but it's three separate pieces. So if we go back and look at all the pieces, this is the base layer that we're working with. And we can see that this is the layer that has this lady standing up so that we can bridge the edit here to her standing up in this medium shot. But we have this other lady up in the crowd who's moving her head, which is pretty distracting. We're waiting here to see what the audience's reaction is going to be to Louis B. Mayer cutting their pay. So seeing her bored, moving her head around is not necessarily helping the scene. So this piece here that is just the right side of the crowd is actually removing that movement. So now as I scrub through, you can see that our lady in the foreground still stands up as we want her to.
Yes.
But where that slice was for the right side of the crowd, it now removes the distracting head movement that we were seeing on the right side of frame. The reason that we have another layer here is because we need to have this lady in the foreground standing up, but we also need Louis B. Mayer to not be talking. He's waiting for the audience's reaction.
Well, I vote yes.
But in the comp that we currently have, where our lady in the front stands up and we've cleaned up the distracting head movement, if you look, Louis is talking over there. So we've added an additional split here, which is just the layer of Louis to right. make sure that he's not talking.
Did I see this correctly? But is there a lens flare on her in the final?
Yes, that is absolutely correct.
So is that added?
Yeah, the lens flare was placed based on how the lens would have reacted to the light that would represent the lensing at the time.
Would you say it's coincidental that the flare is right on her, or do you think that's part of the storytelling that it even highlights more where to look at?
It's very possible that it was coincidental and it was working, so it didn't get removed. It's totally possible also from David's perspective, not only are there really no mistakes, but he's very attentive to how things would actually have worked. So he may not have disliked it, regardless of whether or not it was calling your eye to her or covering her up.
Well, I vote yes.
I do as well.
Me too.
There are also other comps that we do that can be, you know, a little bit more fun, not just quite technical roto. And that's something like this, where the moon was actually added. The way that we do that is through dynamic link.
Don't flagellate, at least you're writing again.
Dynamic linking sets Adobe apart from other editing software. It allows you to make changes to visual effect shots in After Effects and then automatically update those changes to your timeline in Adobe Premiere.
And what we have here is the original take of Rita walking, and here is the original plate of the moon.
Okay.
That was shot on location. The moon had set by the time the action of Rita was actually happening. So this was shot separately and we were going to comp that in. And the way that we do that is actually surprisingly simple with the way that dynamic link works. We'll take both of those layers and just duplicate them up to a new track, select them both, and say replace with After Effects composition. It'll load After Effects. This is the linked comp that was now created in the dynamic link from Premiere. I'm going to do this very, very roughly. Let's just say that we're going to put the moon, we're going to scale it up, and we're going to put it down here. This is all for the purpose of showing how dynamic link works. I'm aware that this is a very bad comp.
Ben did a very quick and dirty version of how they would create a soft mask to blend two shots together and track the movement of the camera so that the added moon would move in sync and always show the right perspective.
Oh, it's perfect.
Ah.
Right, couldn't, that's how it should have been in the movie. So the moment I hit save on this, this is now live over in Premiere. And now I don't need to do any work bringing anything new into Premiere. It's just keeping the linkages. And if for some reason it turns out that this moon was supposed to be a lot smaller, now in my working comp, it would say, oh, well, based on the notes, the moon's supposed to be this big and it's supposed to be rotated this way. Save, come back over. And now that the new comp is done and it's working with our workflow, you can see that I have the comp of the moon in here, but I still have the elements underneath it. And on a movie like Mank, where these comps that we're doing in offline aren't final, having the assets right here so that this can be used by the VFX team, or even if it was, you know, something that was just cleanup that might happen in the DI grading session, we still don't want to get rid of that because that original clip is what's going to be used to do the full resolution pulls from the camera source media. Right. So you always want to have a workflow that in some way preserves your original sources.
This is really helpful. I mean, this is the perfect workflow with dynamic link, which I've never really fully grasped. I'm always constantly recutting new things in there. I never really understood how to do it in a way that it's always alive. I can always go back.
Ben perfected this workflow to make sure that any changes made can be tracked, revised, and reversed easily.
Anyone that is actually using dynamic link, this is the way to do it.
But with credit for a risky undertaking must go the weight of real responsibility.
Ben will share his advice on how to become an A-list assistant editor, but first I'd like to thank Skillshare for their support. It's an online learning community where millions come together to take the next step in their creative or career journey. It offers thousands of classes on topics including illustration design, photography, video, freelancing, and more. I'd like to recommend a series of classes by the infamously charming and witty Jordy from Cinecom, a YouTube channel with over 2 million subscribers.
The name is Jordy, but for you, it's Professor.
Jordy took to Skillshare to give you an in-depth training on Adobe Premiere and After Effects.
So join me into the most complete and entertaining Premiere Pro class.
If you're new to Premiere, check out his beginner class. If you're already way ahead, then his advanced class will take your skills to perfection.
By the end of the class, you'll know everything about the editing program. There's nothing more to learn.
And finally, he gets you up to speed with After Effects, which puts you ahead of most editors who still don't quite know how to incorporate motion graphics to their toolbox.
I'm gonna teach you how to create that, and also how to create this over here without needing to know many technical bells and whistles.
And this is what's great about Skillshare. It's curated specifically for learning, meaning there are no ads, and they're always launching new premium classes so you can stay focused and follow wherever your creativity takes you. So take advantage now. The first 1,000 of my subscribers to click the link in the description will get a 1 month free trial of Skillshare so you can start exploring your creativity today. And now back to Ben and how to break into the biz and leave your creative mark.
You as the assistant editor, do you have a lot of opportunity to be creatively part of that process?
You know, Kirk has been kind enough in the past to say, hey, why don't you take a shot at this and I'll take a look at it and pick it up from there. It can be a very nerve-wracking experience to say like, oh, hey, here, why don't you do this? And personally, you're like, oh, this is the one shot. And if you screw it up, then everyone's just going to know that it didn't work out. My feelings about the collaboration is that it's not just, oh, I need to be editing a scene. You know, which scene did I cut? What do I have ownership over? Where have right. I been a part of this? And I think that that is a disservice to what we're all trying to do. In order to make something like Mank, you can't be so precious over that ownership. You sort of need to be willing to say, like, oh, we're all doing this together and it's all of ours when it's done. So what can I do to help?
Yeah, and that leads to my question, which is basically like, what can an aspiring editor do who's like, yeah, I want to go through this experience. Like, I want to assist. Are there some specific traits or some tricks that it maybe worked for you that you could share for aspiring editors?
I really enjoy the technical side of things. I did become known as like, that's the guy that can fix that. That's the guy that can make this work. That's the guy that knows how to do it. For a long time, I thought that I had needed to fight this battle between wanting to be creative, but being very interested in the technical at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And say like, oh, wait a minute, should I not be pursuing a creative career? I want to be doing it, but oh, look at all these other skills that I have. Am I just fighting myself? I never limited myself to this is the only thing that I'm going to do, and I'm not going to let anyone else believe that these are the only skills that I have and I can't do anything else. Through some luck, ended up finding my way over to David's office and David's team, where creative and technical go 100% hand in hand.
Mank. It's Orson Welles.
Mank tells the story of the somewhat underappreciated writer behind the iconic Orson Welles film Citizen Kane, which is arguably the greatest American movie of all times. Orson Welles is credited with making this masterpiece, but it was actually Herman Mankiewicz who was hired to come up with the story mostly on his own and almost got cheated out of winning the Oscar.
You know, Mr. Thatcher, at the rate of $1 million a year,
I'll have to close this place in 60 years.
Now, in terms of the editing, has there been a discussion to make it like Citizen Kane?
Even though we're making a movie about Citizen Kane rather than recreating Citizen Kane, kind of using the same cinematic styles, where we ended up was, let's take all of the things that are tributes and incorporate them, but not neglect the fact that we're still making a modern day movie. There was never anything that was said like, oh, you can't make that edit because that type of edit wouldn't have been done. Or you can't use that camera angle because how would they have done that? Or how would they have lit that? Or they didn't have visual effects back in the day, so you can't use visual effects. You have to use a matte painting. None of those rules were adhered to. I think we found the best balance of the two.
Well, Ben, thank you so much for taking the time and walking us through the film.
Are you interested in taking an editing class taught by me? For the first time, I'm offering a free mini course called Secret Editing Hacks. In this 30-minute lesson, I show you my number one editing hack I use for every feature film and documentary I cut. Pro editors don't rely on talent. They develop a system that guarantees that their cuts are always the best they can be and is efficient.
The best way to show you to bring up an old example.
The system I use is something I developed and refined in over 20 years. Take advantage. Click the link and get access to my secret editing hacks for free. Thanks for watching and happy editing.